Good afternoon, Southminster scholars. Welcome back to our exploration of the solar system. Before we begin, I want to remind you of this year's Superheroes Fund, for our hourly paid employees. As a reminder, we have over 380 of those employees who serve us daily. Other than their hourly wage, they receive no other compensation during the year, so this is the time of year we come together as a group of residents to honor those folks who serve us so diligently and so well. We ask and we expect 100% participation from our residents. We hope that you will join us in that regard. This year, as a reminder, your gift is tax deductible. And if you will make your payment to the community fund, and on the fore line of your check, put Superheroes Fund, then deposit that check in the payment slots in the North Terraces, the South Terraces, the main building, as well as healthcare. It will be greatly appreciated and credited. Your name will be added to the list of what we've come to call as our Angels Fund. But this year it'll be called our Heroes Fund, that you will see throughout the complex. Now for today, we're going to journey to the center of the planets. Earth's surface provides many clues about its interior. There exists a dynamic interaction between the surface and the interior that we see in the idea of plate tectonics. Earth's crust is only 1% of the radius of the planet. The volume is a rocky mantle as well as an inner core. The larger planets are gaseous on the exterior and more liquid in their interiors. While their core is rock, the size of many Earths. Dr. Summers today will lead us from the surface to the core of Earth, as well as other planets, comparing and contrasting those differences. Let's enjoy our video today.
In 1864, Jules Verne published the book, A Journey to the Center of the Earth. In it, Professor Liedenbrock leads his nephew and a hired guide down a volcano in Iceland, and they have many adventures where they sail across a subterranean ocean, they meet prehistoric creatures, they are hit by underground lightning, and they see a 12-foot-tall ape man, which they can't decide, is it ape man or man ape? And upon looking at that, I wondered, is that related to the fact that Darwin's On the Origin of Species was published 5 years earlier? But at the end of their adventures, they come to the surface in southern Italy via a steam vent of a volcano. Now, unfortunately, I don't think truth is stranger than fiction in this case, because as we explore planetary interiors, we will see a subterranean ocean, but it will be made of magma, not water, so you couldn't really sail across it. Instead of lightning, we'll find magnetism, and won't meet any prehistoric creatures, although there is a chance of life on Europa. Our trip to the interior will be based on bulk measures and external properties, because really we have no chance of making in situ measurements in the interior of any planet. We'll spend most of our time looking at Earth, where the data is strongest, and as we extrapolate to the other planets and bodies of the solar system, we'll have to be guided by mathematical models. And generally, when we look at the interior, we're really biased towards explaining the surface characteristics of the planets. So we'll begin where Verne begins his adventure, on Earth's surface. Earth is a rocky planet, so let's take a look at the rocks and see what we can tell about the interior from just looking at the rocks. There are three main types of rocks: igneous, sedimentary, and metamorphic. Igneous rocks are rocks that cooled from a molten state. Now, molten rock is called lava when it flows across the surface, and it's called magma when it's beneath the surface. Examples of igneous rocks include basalt and granite. Sedimentary rocks are rocks that have been deposited over time by wind, water, snow. For example, layers of sand can be compressed and you get sandstone. If the minerals precipitate out of the oceans and form on the ocean floor, you can create limestone. It's interesting to note that the rocks at the top of Mount Everest are limestone. These are sedimentary rocks that formed at the bottom of an ocean and then were pushed up to form the highest mountain in the world. Metamorphic rocks are reprocessed rocks. If you subject igneous or sedimentary rocks to high pressures and temperatures, they will change their structure. Fine-grained igneous rocks become a different type of rock called schist. Limestone becomes marble. So when you're picking out your countertops and you have a choice between granite and marble countertops, here's the difference. Granite are igneous rocks. They've been molten once and then they solidified, while marble is a metamorphic rock that was processed as a sedimentary rock and then reprocessed to form marble. Probably that extra step in production means that marble costs a little bit extra. The implications from rocks for the interior of our planet are twofold. One, it shows that magma flows up from the interior. There must be some sort of magma ocean beneath our water oceans where the magma can rise up and form our igneous rocks. Second thing is that rocks must also flow down into the interior. Some of the crust is recycled because you're taking these igneous and sedimentary rocks and pushing them down into high temperatures and pressure to become the metamorphic rocks. Next, let's take a look at the oceans. Here is the standard picture of Earth's surface, and you can see that oceans cover 70% of the surface. There are five major ones: the Pacific, the Atlantic, the Indian, and down near Antarctic, there is the Southern Ocean that we don't talk about very much. And then at the northern latitudes, we have the Arctic Ocean. The average depths of these oceans is about 13,000 to 16,000 feet, about the height of a really good mountain, but this is actually depth in the sea. The only one that's different is the Arctic Ocean, and it's a rather shallow ocean, goes only to about 4,000 feet deep. The deepest points of the ocean are shown in this topo map, where you can see trenches. Now, trenches tend to occur along the edges of continents. Along the west coast of South America, you can see the Peru-Chile Trench. Along the west coast of North America and stretching along past Alaska is the Aleutian Trench. And then down past Japan, you have the Japanese Trench, and stretching out into the Pacific, you have the Mariana Trench. The depths of these trenches can reach to 36,000 feet. Now that sounds really deep, but let's put it in perspective with respect to our planet. The average depth of the ocean is perhaps 5 kilometers, and the deepest is only 11 kilometers. Now, let's add in the mountains. 11 kilometers deep for the oceans, but you know, add in the 9 kilometers of height for the mountains, you get about 20 kilometers of vertical relief. That's really only 0.3% of Earth's 6,400 kilometer radius. Now, I have here a globe, and some globes have vertical relief on them, where you can feel the mountain chains. If this globe had perfectly accurate vertical relief, going from the highest mountains to the deepest trenches, the thickness on a 12-inch globe, or 6-inch radius, would be less than 0.5 millimeter. You could rub your hand across it, and you still could not feel it. That's why most globes have really, really, really exaggerated vertical relief. The other feature of the sea floor are what we call ridges. And in this topo map, we emphasize the ridges. And you can see running down the center of the Atlantic Ocean, the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. And off the west coast of South America, we have the East Pacific Rise. And flowing underneath Australia and India, we have the ridges in the East Indian Ocean. These are like undersea mountain ranges. They can reach up to 5,000 feet above the sea floor. And sometimes, especially in the Mid-Atlantic Ridge, they're cut by a rift valley. So you have the mountains, and then you have a rift valley cutting through them. We interpret these ocean features under the guise of plate tectonics. In this image, we show you the plates of Earth. Earth's crust is divided into 8 large plates and a few smaller ones. We have the North American plate and the South American plate. We have the Eurasian plate, which stretches from Europe across Asia, the African plate. We have the Indo-Australian plate from India and Australia. And we have the Pacific plate down bottom. And then we have one plate that's just to the west of South America, which is called the Nazca plate. Those are the major 8 major plates. There are also a host of minor plates. And the most easily recognizable one is the Arabian plate that includes Saudi Arabia. Now, with these plates, you can see the boundaries of these plates fit with the ridges. And where these plates intersect are the regions of the trenches. The trenches are interpreted as regions of subduction, where one plate is going underneath another. The ridges are the creation of new plate material. The magma rises from the interior, pushes up these mountains, it solidifies and creates new plate material, and then the plates spread away from the ridges. This motion can be measured, and it's about a few centimeters per year. So if you think your flight from the U.S. to Europe is long, it's only going to get longer as they actually are spreading apart from one another. The evidence for plate tectonics is incredibly strong, and they come from earthquakes and volcanoes. This is a map of where earthquakes have occurred over a 5-year period. You'll notice that it very strongly matches the seafloor topography that I just showed you. The number and strength of earthquakes are highest at plate boundaries. Now you'll also note that earthquakes can occur away from the plate boundaries. I take a look, and I live in the eastern United States, and I see there are a significant number of earthquakes that occur in the eastern United States. I'm told that a moderate earthquake in Boston could do more damage than a stronger one in San Francisco because the building codes do not anticipate earthquakes in the Northeast. The same is true for volcanoes. Here is a map of where volcanoes are found on our planet. They are not randomly distributed throughout our planet, but again, they match with the location of the trenches. The subduction of a plate underneath another plate leads to volcanic activity on the continental plate next to it. But once again, you will notice that the correlation is not perfect. In particular, there are some volcanoes here in the middle of the Pacific plate. This is Hawaii. Why are there volcanoes in Hawaii? This is as far away from either side of a plate as you can possibly get. Well, let's take a look at the Hawaiian Islands. This is an overhead map of the Hawaiian Islands, and you can see the big island actually contains 2 very large volcanoes. The northern one is Mauna Kea, and that's dormant, and the southern one is Mauna Loa, and that's still active. The idea of how you can get these volcanoes out in the middle of the Pacific plate is something called hotspot volcanism. There is a magma hotspot underneath the Pacific plate, and that magma pushes up through the Pacific plate and forms these volcanoes. As the plate moves across the hot spot, new islands in the chain grow. And you can see here from the state of Hawaii that the islands sort of continue off to the northwest. If I take a wider view, you can see that it isn't just the islands that we see today, but there are considerably more islands that have been there previously. And if I look at a topo map, you can see that if I remove the water, then you can see that there is a huge long chain from Hawaii down here all the way up across the Pacific plate. There is at least 70 million years of hotspot volcanism in the Hawaiian island chain. And there's a new volcano that is forming just south of the big island, and they call it Lauihi. And that eventually would become the new island in the Hawaiian chain. So that sort of inspires an intriguing question. What is the history of the plate motion? How have these plates been structured over history? Well, here are how the continents look today. And one thing you will notice is how the bulge of South America on the east coast would fit very neatly into the west coast of Africa. The Mid-Atlantic Ridge has separated these two continents over millions of years. If you look 60 million years ago, the continents were closer. And you can also note how far India is from the Eurasian plate. India over the last 60 million years has been a relative speed demon. It's been traveling at up to 15 centimeters per year. If we look back 120 million years ago, this was a time when South America and Africa were in contact. 180 million years ago, the Atlantic Ocean disappears. Matter of fact, we only have one much larger ocean, and we have the continent that's called Pangaea, one supercontinent composed of all the continents that we know today. Going further back to 240 million years, the land masses seem to migrate a little bit south. And going to 300 million years, it still remains mostly one continent as it continues to migrate south even further. At 360 million years ago, you can see that most of the land mass is below the equator. And when I look at this, I say, maybe that north-south dichotomy on Mars, where there's a significantly different topography in the south compared to the north, well, I guess it doesn't look so strange anymore. At 420 million years ago, it's no longer one continent. So the supercontinent of Pangaea was just a temporary state. North America has broken off. And I also think it's kind of fun to look at this and say, hey, look, Alaska, Greenland, and Russia, all of them straddle the equator. So we conclude that the continental plates have been drifting across an interior layer of the planet. Well, I guess drifting is one word, but I think floating is a better word, because that will lead to the idea that's important to discuss next, and that's differentiation. We all know that oil and water don't mix. If you put oil and water together and you shake it up and just let it sit, eventually the water will drop to the bottom and the oil will rise to the top. The water is more dense and it sinks to the bottom. For planets, this idea is called differentiation. It's basically the simple gravitational separation of materials of different density. It requires, however, that the body must have been liquid at some point during its formation. So massive objects will have high temperature and pressure due to gravity. They naturally will become differentiated. What's more important for smaller bodies is the heat generated during formation. The cooling efficiency of a body is really a ratio of its surface area to its volume. And if these things are roughly spherical, the area is proportional to the radius squared, and the volume is proportional to the radius cubed. So the cooling efficiency goes up with size. Smaller objects will cool more efficiently. So you will expect large objects to be differentiated, but the smaller objects will be able to cool away their heat. They won't necessarily become liquid, and we might expect those to be undifferentiated. The tool that we'll use to explore the interior structure is seismology. And it's simply that earthquakes trigger seismic waves, and some of those seismic waves will pass along the Earth's surface. These are the ones you feel when you're involved in an earthquake. I did my graduate work at the University of California at Berkeley, and I experienced a number of these. Most of them were kind of fun, a little rolling of the room, but I was also there during the 7.2 Loma Prieta earthquake, and that one scared me a little. But the other seismic waves, the ones that are useful for exploring the interior, are the ones that are going to go downward and through the interior. And the speed of these waves is dependent on the density of the medium. They can also change direction or bounce when there are boundaries between different density mediums. This is like, you know, refraction or reflection with light waves. When the wave hits the boundary, it can bounce back or it can change its direction. There are two types of waves that we will consider. First are called primary waves. These are what scientists call acoustic waves, and they propagate like sound waves. There's a compression and rarefaction as it moves along, just like the sound waves that you hear. The second type are called secondary waves, and these are shear waves. They're a side-to-side motion. So this is like when you're wiggling a string or a bullwhip back side-to-side. That's a wave passing this way. You will note that for a shear wave to work, if I push this piece of a body to the side, it needs to have some connection to the next piece of the body to pull it. Therefore, these shear waves can't propagate through a liquid, because if I pull a little bit of liquid to the side, the next bit doesn't go side to side. So it's an important property is that the primary waves can pass through solids and liquids, but the shear waves can only pass through solids. The basic idea is that you know the epicenter of the quake. You measure the strength of the waves on the surface, determine the epicenter of the quake, and then around the globe at the seismic stations, you measure which waves arrive and when they arrive. If, for example, no secondary wave arrives, then you know there must be a liquid layer between that seismic station and the epicenter of the quake. The time of arrival will indicate the average density of the material that it passed through. Now, in this way, you can work to build up a model of the interior. It's not going to be a simple solution, simply because you do have these boundaries and you have reflections and refractions, but with enough data over many years, we've built up a very good model of the Earth's interior. Earth's interior structure is considered to be composed of several layers. Basically, the basic layers are crust, mantle, and core. The crust is roughly 60 kilometers thick, only about 1% of Earth's radius. It's composed of the low-density materials. And as you would expect, the low-density materials are the stuff that are going to float to the top of a differentiation process. It really is not very significant because it only contains 0.4% of Earth's mass. It is, however, very significant to us because it's where we live. One question we have is, why isn't there more crust? If you look at the materials that we think formed our Earth, we expect there should be 200 kilometers of crust. However, if you do the calculations, at around 60 kilometers, the pressure and temperature become so great that the materials of the crust undergo what's called a phase change. They become higher density materials, and the bottom of the crust peels off, or what they say delaminates, and then starts to sink. So the crust is kept at about 60 kilometers thick through this process. The mantle, the middle layer, is composed of rock and extends about halfway down to the center. It contains two-thirds of Earth's mass. There are three subregions in the mantle. You have the upper mantle, and that contains the asthenosphere. This is a region that acts like a fluid on geologic times. It's still rock, but over very millions of years, it actually flows. And there is a slow convection in the asthenosphere, and the lithospheric plates float atop this plastic region. At the bottom of the upper mantle is what they call the transition region. This is maybe the source of the basaltic magmas. This is where materials that have peeled off from the crust and dropped down become heated enough that they regain their buoyancy and again start their rise back up to the surface. The lower mantle is solid. It contains the higher density materials that form under really high pressure. About half the mass of the Earth is in the lower mantle. Below that, we have the core. This is mostly iron with a little bit of nickel. It contains about one-third of the mass of Earth. It was probably all liquid at one point, but the interior of the Earth has cooled enough that there is an inner core, which is solid. Earth's interior structure, crust, mantle, core, serves as a template for understanding the other rocky planets. If we look at Venus, Venus is expected to have a similar interior structure to Earth. The major difference is that Venus is a one-plate planet. We're not exactly sure why. When we look at Venus, the tectonic features are spread everywhere, not like on Earth where they were aligned with plate boundaries. There are no plate boundaries on Venus. The entire surface appears to be no older than a few hundred million years. So the tectonics are expected to be compressional, sideways, and up and down. Here is a view of the Aphrodite Terra on Venus. And in the center, the red pinkish regions are Ovda Regio and Thetis Regio. These are called tesserae. And these are some of the oldest regions on the surface of Venus. They show this complex deformation and probably were caused by convective motions in the mantle raising and lowering the crust. This obviously was followed by planet-wide resurfacing because over 80% of the planet is volcanic plains. So for Venus, lava flows are the most significant interior manifestation on the surface. Mercury has a very high density that indicates that it has a very large iron core. The iron core extends more than two-thirds of the radius of the planet. Originally, we believe that it would have cooled off and become solid, but recent observations have shown that at least it is partially molten. Now, Mercury shows no tectonics, but it does show an interesting feature called fault scarps. This is an image of a scarp, and what the scarp is this line working from the center down through these craters. This is a geologic fault, and the features like these indicate that the region of the surface has compressed. We believe that perhaps there even was global contraction of the entire planet during its formation. It formed and it was hot and slowly cooled and cracked as it cooled. Mars has a lower density than the other rocky planets. Earth's density is up over 5 grams per cubic centimeter. Mars is more like our moon and down around 3 grams per cubic centimeter. It likely has a lower percentage of iron in its composition, and therefore it has a correspondingly smaller core. The core of Mars only extends out to about 30% of its radius instead of 50% as we see here on Earth. The expression on its surface in Mars is most noticeable in a region called the Tharsis Bulge. In this topographic map, you can see this giant red region over here that has been uplifted several kilometers above the average radius of Mars. In the Tharsis Bulge are the giant volcanoes, including Olympus Mons, the largest volcano in the solar system. This likely indicates that in the mantle of Mars, there has been sustained regional motions that have continued to push up. We don't know why this should be, and particularly why it should last for billions of years that it obviously has in order to produce the extensive volcanism we see here. I would say that compared to Earth's plate tectonics, the other rocky planets have relatively mild expressions of their interiors in their surface features. If we look at the large moons and the minor planets, we don't see any tectonics. What we see is really a sequence from differentiated bodies down to undifferentiated bodies. We start with the moon. The moon has a relatively low density compared to Earth, about the same as Mars, and it means that it probably does not have a core. This diagram here shows a core, but considering the density, we really doubt that it has a true iron core. The moon is geologically dead. We see some ancient crustal extension and contraction, stuff that happened during its formation, but it has had no activity for the past 2.5 billion years. As for the asteroids, we would expect the small bodies of the asteroids to cool efficiently, and the heat of formation would be lost, and therefore they would not be differentiated. Unfortunately, the evidence disagrees with our expectations. We have see iron meteorites. They fall to Earth, and these can only come from a differentiated body. They are pure iron on these meteorites, and they seem to indicate the complete breakup of differentiated bodies in the asteroid belts. So some asteroids must be differentiated, and we'd expect the largest ones to be. Here's a diagram of the largest one, Ceres, and it is likely to have a differentiated interior. We have observations that show it has a difference between its crust and an icy layer below that crust. The density of Ceres requires that there be a rocky interior below that. And this diagram doesn't show an iron core, but we believe that to be present as well. Only a few other asteroids are large enough to be differentiated, and most asteroids, we believe, are undifferentiated. Moving on to the Galilean moons, the most interesting one is Europa. This image here shows what we call the ice rafts of Europa. This is a fractured surface that shows a complicated jumble of ice. In a global view, we see much longer striations, these long lines and fractures that extend across most of its surface. This image looks somewhat like what we see here on Earth at the North Pole. Now, these radial lines are just indicating where the North Pole exists, but these other lines are fractures in the ice above the Arctic Ocean. We take the same idea and apply it to Europa and deduce that there might be a subsurface ocean on Europa. So Europa's interior is differentiated, has a metallic core and a rocky interior, but out towards the edge, it has covered with ice and may have perhaps a 10 kilometer deep ocean. The evidence is consistent with this ocean only existing in the past, so we're not entirely sure that the ocean exists at present. If we look at the other Galilean moons, in the upper left we have Io, then we have Europa in the upper right, we have Ganymede in the lower left, we have Callisto in the lower right. These are diagrams of their interiors as inferred from gravity field and magnetic field measurements. All but Callisto are believed to be differentiated. They have an iron core surrounded by rock, and all but Io have an icy surface. Io, of course, has extensive volcanism and would not have an icy surface. It is interesting to note that Ganymede and Callisto may also have subsurface oceans. The evidence for this comes from a small variability in their magnetic field. We noticed on Europa that its magnetic field varies just a little bit, perhaps due to the subsurface ocean. Now, to do this, to create a magnetic field, you need an internal conducting fluid, because electricity and magnetism are complementary. Wherever you have an electric current, you generate a magnetic field. If a magnetic field changes, you generate an electric current. So for Ganymede and Callisto, when we see changes in their magnetic field, the best explanation we can come up with is a subsurface ocean. Now, Europa and Callisto have only tiny magnetic fields. They're really not intrinsic to the body themselves. They're more a response to Jupiter's magnetic field. Ganymede, however, has a thick ocean layer and has a significant, in this drawing, is drawn with a thick ocean layer because it has a significant internal magnetic field. Moving on to Saturn, its large moon Titan is also suspected of having a subsurface ocean. It is larger than Mercury, so we expect it to be differentiated, have rock and ice interior. We also suspect that it has a water and ammonia liquid layer about 50 kilometers below its icy surface. At the very outer edge of the solar system, Neptune has a large moon, Triton. Triton is thought to be an undifferentiated mix of ice and rock. This is due to its gentler formation in a cold region of the solar system. I also note that ices can stick together under gentle collisions and don't need to heat up that much. Pluto is very similar to Triton in most properties, but it's just a little smaller. So we would expect basically the same interior for Pluto. Finally, we turn to the giant planets. The interiors for these are mostly determined by modeling, and we find that Jupiter and Saturn are different from Uranus and Neptune. Jupiter and Saturn are composed roughly of solar composition of hydrogen and helium, 75% hydrogen, 25% helium. The outer layer is gaseous molecular hydrogen. These are the atmospheres that we see. But as you go deeper and deeper into it, that gas becomes really more like a hot liquid. And at about 1 million times Earth's atmospheric pressure, the hydrogen breaks down and becomes a liquid called metallic hydrogen. In the very center, below this metallic hydrogen, there's a core, and we presume it to be a mass of rock about 15 times the mass of Earth. We have no direct evidence for it, but we need to postulate this mass of rock as a nucleus for the formation of Jupiter and Saturn. Basically, you need enough mass to attract and hold the gases that form the rest of the planet. Jupiter's density indicates that it is dominated by its liquid hydrogen phase. So, though we call it a gas giant, from this viewpoint, it's really more a liquid giant. And Saturn's density is actually below that of water. In fact, by volume, it's mostly gaseous hydrogen. Uranus and Neptune are significantly smaller. They formed farther out in the solar system, and instead of accreting gas, because they didn't have enough mass, they instead accreted ices. The ices in this case means water, ammonia, and methane. Uranus and Neptune's interior starts with a small rocky core of perhaps a few Earth masses. Then outside that, we have a dominant component that is hot, highly compressed liquid. This is the ices and various chemical species derived from these ices. The outer 15% of these planets is molecular hydrogen gas. So Uranus and Neptune show a completely different structure from Jupiter and Saturn, and some people refer to these guys as ice giants as compared to Jupiter and Saturn as gas giants or even liquid giants. That completes our journey to the centers of the planets. Now you may notice that there's one external manifestation that we've not yet discussed. Magnetic fields are generated in the interior of most planets, but the effects are seen on the exterior. In particular, magnetic fields interact strongly with the solar wind. We will discuss magnetic fields in detail in the context of solar storms in a few lectures. In the meantime, we're just going to work our way out to that region. Our next lecture will move from planetary interiors to planetary atmospheres. We'll see you then. Take care.
She packed my bags last night, pre-flight. 0 hour, 9 a.m. And I'm gonna be high as a kite by then. I miss the earth so much, I miss my wife. It's lonely out in space on such a timeless flight. Touchdown brings me round again to find I'm not the man they think I am at home. Oh no, 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 I'm a rocket man, rocket man, burning out his fuse out of home. And I think it's gonna be a long, long time to touchdown brings round again to find I'm not the man that think I am at home. Oh no, 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 I'm a rocket man, burning out his fuse out here alone. Mars ain't the kind of place to raise your kids. Fact is cold as hell, and there's no one there to raise them. I don't understand. It's just my job 5 days a week. A rocket man. A rocket man. And I think it's gonna be a long, long time till touchdown brings me round again to find I'm not the man they think I am at home. Oh, no, no, no. I'm a rocket man. Rocket man. Burning out his fuse out there alone. And I think it's gonna be I think it's gonna be a long, long time.